Thank you very much. First, I would like to thank the management of ICD who gave me this opportunity to talk about our work, which is, you know, the humanitarian fund for Afghanistan. I know this is a bit different than people are talking about the culture, but already my colleague talked about the culture of Afghanistan. So this presentation will be very short, therefore I would like to have your attention about this presentation and have any questions to respond. So what is the main objective of the fund that we have in Afghanistan? So it is called Afghanistan Humanitarian Fund, and this is managed under the OCHA, United Nations Office for Coordination of Humanitarian Assistance. It is a pooled fund mechanism so that the donor from different countries, they want to help Afghanistan. What they do, they provide all their fund to this pooled fund, and then this pooled fund will allocate the fund for humanitarian assistance. And then, because it is a pooled fund, then we have got enough fund here as a reserve to, you know, to timely and to support the timely and anticipated humanitarian issues. And also, it strengthened the leadership of humanitarian coordinator in Afghanistan and cluster coordination. Humanitarian coordinator is the highest official rank of United Nations in Afghanistan, who deals with humanitarian issues. And then we have got cluster system. With the cluster system, I mean, like, for example, we have got nutrition cluster, wash cluster, emergency cluster, and all organizations that they work in, for example, in nutrition, so they are called as a cluster. So this is the management structure of the fund, how the fund is structured. So you see that at the top we have got humanitarian coordinator that who is the ultimate responsible for the management of the fund, and then he is supported by the advisory board. Advisory board provide support to the humanitarian coordinator in terms of policy and strategy for the management of the fund. And then we have got humanitarian financing unit who works in terms of operational and technicality for the management of the fund. And then cluster coordinators. Cluster coordinators are the ones that who prioritize the needs for each cluster. For example, what are the needs in terms of nutrition? What are the needs in terms of wash or food security? And then those priorities will be funded. So then we have got implementing partners. Implementing partners are the ones that who actually implement the fund. We receive the fund, manage the fund, and then we give the fund to the implementing partners who do the actual work on the ground. So why AHF or why Afghanistan Humanitarian Fund? Somebody will say, okay, why I should give fund you? It is because it avoids duplication of funding and program overlapping. For example, Germany may support a program in a specific part of Afghanistan. Then it's possible Denmark is also supporting the same program in that specific part of Afghanistan. And if they individually, without coordination, do the support, there will be duplication. But if they support this fund, provide their fund to their help to this fund, pool fund, which is called Afghanistan Humanitarian Fund, then there will be the duplication and overlapping of the program will be avoided. Then it's also a good funding channel for donors with no presence on the ground. For example, Republic of Korea wanted to help for Afghanistan, but they do not have any presence in Afghanistan. So it is very easier for them that they provide the fund directly to pool fund, to this pool fund, and then the fund will be allocated for the strategic and critical needs of Afghanistan. And then this fund has got a very robust accountability framework that is inclusive of the audit system, monitoring system, and reporting system to ensure that the fund is spent in the best possible way and any possible fraud is detected and avoided. And then it is cost effective. For example, if Germany, an example like Germany wants to, you know, to help humanitarian assistance in Afghanistan and open their own office over there for this purpose, then they have to, then there is a lot of administrative cost. But if they do their support through this fund, then it can all the unnecessary administrative cost will be avoided. And then who are eligible organizations that they work as an implementing partner for Afghanistan Humanitarian Fund? It is UN agency, It is international organization like international NGOs, national NGOs. And then how we select these partners? These partners will be selected through two programs. One is called a due diligence, which is a desk review of their documentation. And then the second one is capacity assessment. And through the capacity assessment, it is actually, we have contracted out KPMG, and KPMG goes to each organization, check their program and operations, and make sure that if they are, you know, the right partner to implement the project. And then the results after the report, there will be a rating system, and all the organizations that were selected as a eligible organization for the fund, they will be rated as high risk, medium risk, low risk partners. And how is allocation happen? Once you're an eligible organization, it doesn't mean that you will receive fund. But what, you have to provide proposal, and your proposal will go through the allocation process. We have got two kind of allocation. One is a standard allocation, the second one is a reserve allocation. A standard allocation is for all foreseen predicted needs in Afghanistan, while reserve allocation is for the one which are unforeseen. For example, earthquake, that you cannot predict that. So if that happens, then any humanitarian assistance for that purpose will be helped through the reserve allocation. And then we have got allocation process. Your proposal will go through two process. One is called SRC, Strategic Review Committee, and then the other one is Technical Review Committee. The Strategic Review Committee makes sure that your proposal is strategic relevant, while the Technical Review Committee makes sure that your proposal is complete, your budget is okay, and all missing information is provided and accurate. And this is the performance or achievement of this fund for 2015. So the Afghanistan Humanitarian Fund for the United Nations in Afghanistan received about 38.5 million in contributions, and then we allocated this fund for different projects for 37.9 million. We have got 58 projects that they all supported: wash, water, you know, and hygiene, sanitation, for the health, for the shelter and emergency assistance, all those critical needs. The needs in Afghanistan are many, but what we do, those critical life-saving needs, those kind of projects will be prioritized and will be supported. We have, and then this fund was implemented, and then this 58 project was implemented by 35 implementing partners, and we have reached to 3.4 million beneficiaries who were displaced as a result of conflict and natural disaster. So these are main Afghanistan humanitarian fund donors, which you can see that obviously most of them are European Union, and what United Kingdom is one of the biggest donor. Then we have got Germany, Australia, Sweden, Republic of Korea, Norway, and Denmark. These are of course the main donors for the fund. So how can you help? If your country would like to help this fund, there are two ways. One is bilateral kind of support between the, you know, a country who want to support the fund. They can support the fund through the MPTF office, which is a multi-trust partner, you know, office within the UNDP in New York. And then there we have got private and public sector contributions, and those can be received through United Nations Foundations with a very less administrative charge. This was a very short information about what we do for Afghanistan Humanitarian Fund, and it is the end of the presentation. So if you have any question, please ask your question.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hamid, for your presentation. Yes, please. Question and comment?
That is a wonderful presentation, well educative and full of information. What I want to ask you is this. Do you accept contribution or donation for any organization, or you have specific organizations that accept contribution from them? And do you accept it from any country? And if so, I'm a bit surprised that you say these are your major contributors. People like you from the United States, I wonder don't you get anything from their foundations, like build foundations, you know, Gates Foundation, Ford Foundation, all these kind of places? You know, they don't contribute anything? Or is it? What do you have? Hello, excuse me.
Thank you very much.
No, so excuse me, I'm not yet through.
Okay, please.
Yes, I'm still on it. Still on that aspect, do you intend to tell me that this 38 million of stock that you are talking about, you distributed 37 million? That means you are left with just over 600,000 for your overhead cost. Is that, I don't know, is it possible? Overhead cost in the year, so just 600,000?
Can you please repeat the last part of your question?
Yes, what you said here is that you are able to get 38.5 million.
Mm-hmm.
And you distributed 37.9 million. If I'm, yes?
Yep.
Yeah. Good. So what I want to find out is that, you mean this $600,000, is it your overhead cost for the whole year? You mean what I mean by this overhead cost? You pay salaries, you maintain your vehicles, you do all other things. This $600,000, is it? I don't know.
You mean that we got 38.5 million and then we have allocated 37.9 million? Is it sufficient? And then what about our administrative costs? So first of all, of course, United States of America is one of the biggest donors in Afghanistan. And this fund in Afghanistan was established last year, the year before last, in the middle of 2014. And we are in the process of attracting, you know, donors, especially United States. We have recently approached United States to, you know, to help this fund. But right now, the United States, you know, they have kind of bilateral contracts with most of the organization. But our aim is to ensure them that they join this fund. And second about this, so the fund, when we receive the fund goes to the United, it goes to the UN, to MPTF office in New York. They charge only 1% of the total fund that they receive as an administrative cost. And then what we do, we only charge 3% for any project that we fund, 3%. So it is very, in terms, it's very kind of, that's one of our competitive advantage compared to any other type of funding. And of course, you know, United Nations is, it also has other sources of fund. And then it doesn't mean like this is the receive of the fund, but then what we have also some pledges that, you know, the money, bilateral donors, they sign contract with our fund, and then they issue or release the fund in different installments.
Thank you. Yes, I'm coming. Ladies first, if you let me.
Hello, I'm Vladimir, I come from Slovakia. I'm writing my master thesis about the humanitarian aid and development project. My question is, and also in my master thesis, I am focusing on the conditionality which come from this humanitarian aid, and lots of scholars are thinking that this financial support make the country dependent on the funds. What is your point of view to the special funds to Afghanistan? Is any advantage of this for sure there? But is already find out the biggest advantage of special for this funds in Afghanistan?
So. I think that's a very good question. In some countries that they support, and what they have got their own condition, what to support, what not to support. So what we have done, and also we have got humanitarian's need overview and then humanitarian response plan. So the humanitarian needs overview see that for each year what are the needs in the country, and then we have got humanitarian response plan. So what are the our plan to, you know, to do for those things? So that is what we share with our donors, and the donors then based on that they provide their help to our fund. And of course, we do not accept any kind of, you know, any kind of condition from the donor. So the donors should say, for example, this fund should not be sub- should not be allocated to this kind of people or, for example, for that people, because we have already the humanitarian response plan. It is very clear, well detailed. It says, okay, what are the needs in Afghanistan and what are the critical needs? And because we want to help the critical needs for Afghanistan, for example, we did the humanitarian need overview for 2016. About 8.1 million people are in need for the humanitarian support, but out of 8.1 million, 3.5 million are, you know, the ones that who need critical, who were in critical conditions, so they need life-saving kind of support. And overall need for 2016 is about $417 million. So then, of course, all the funds that the donors they help, they not come to the to this pooled fund. Some of them has kind of bilateral arrangement. So our aim is that we have to attract those, and those funds to all be channeled through, you know, through our office, because our offices, Office of Humanitarian Coordinations for Humanitarian Assistance, and it is the United Nations office that works for humanitarian assistance in any country. Thanks. Hopefully I have answered your question.
Yeah. Hello, my name is Adam. I come from Prague, the Czech Republic, and I just wanted to make a point regarding the actual refugee crisis that is hitting Europe pretty strongly. Well, it is a well-known fact that among the refugees, there are not only the citizens of Syria, but there are also a lot of Afghan people. Maybe you could tell me why so many Afghan citizens are leaving Afghanistan. Thank you for your explanation.
Thank you for your question. I think it is a challenging question. So first, our work is all about the humanitarian assistance, like if there is conflict, and then, you know, natural disasters, all these things. But the reason that, and then we work with a lot of displaced, internal displaced people, and also some of the refugees that they, in the border that they came from Pakistan to Afghanistan, so we support them. But the main challenge in Afghanistan is, as everyone knows, is the insecurity in our country. So then, unfortunately, there is not a lot of, you know, work opportunity for our youth. We have, you know, a lot of people that they have graduated from school, but, you know, there is no job for them. So those are the people that they actually, you know, leave the country. And some of them are also, because of the conflict, they have lived in a conflict zone, and some of them are uneducated. They did not receive education, and they cannot do some of the work which is available and which are competitive. Then they think it's better for them to, you know, leave the country and come to Europe to have a better life. But I think it is the fault of our government, I should say. It is my personal opinion that our government needs to do a lot for these, you know, for our youth, to make sure to provide them good, you know, life conditions and in the country. And this was also the point that the other day the member of the parliament talked, that we have to make better condition for the people down there in Afghanistan. If we do that, then they will not come to these countries.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hamid, for your presentation and for answering to the question of our audience. Please join me in our sincere gratitude to Mr. Hamid.
Thank you very much.